All you need is skill. It's about these monsters that are wiping out humanity, and the only thing we can do is to fight them in a all-out war. However, we actually just follow this happy-go-lucky average dude in his first combat mission, in which he instantly dies, and then wakes up 2 days before the mission has started. That's right, our boy Keiji is stuck in a time loop, which resets every time he dies. Which is a lot. From there, we're taken on an adventure with him and his evolution to a cold, hard, methodical killer, and you know, of course, he also needs to find out the reason for the time loop, get better equipment to fight with, and you know, generally try to not go insane. This is great if you're just beginning to read manga, since it can be consumed in like 30 minutes, art is clean, narrative is simple, and technically everything is very tight until you start thinking about it, but you know, I'll talk to you about it after the title drops.
I'm a god.
This was a tough case to crack, since technically everything feels very consistent. You go on this journey, you wanna find out what is happening, you find out, and everything has like kind of a emotionally romantic ending. It's cool on first thought, but when you actually go over what you just fucking read, it's very simple, very generic, and it's like a 6. On a good day, that is, it's a 5 the rest of the time. This is some real mediocre shit. I will go deeper into that whole concept later in the video, but for now I just want to stick to my regular structure and talk about the art for a quick second. And as you can see, it can look amazing, but most of the time it looks very, very serviceable. Yes, sometimes this picks up, other times kind of slows down, but doesn't matter what the situation is, the art is always presented in this very official, in this very clean way. You always understand what is happening, everything is conveyed to you very properly, and some might say in a very generic manner. Is this necessarily bad? No, not by any means. In fact, it gives this very professional look to the manga. Now, is that very great? No. No, not really, it's just kinda like mediocre. However, there are certain parts of the manga in which the art really picks up, and those parts always represent emotion. For example, there are like a good amount of panels in here in which we observe our main character going through a rough time, I guess we could say. And in most of those, you can feel the sheer hopelessness, the pure version of dread coming from our boy, and it's not funny, I don't know why I'm laughing, it's actually very sad. And again, emotion portrayed in a very great way. But there are actually other means in which emotion is portrayed. For example, somebody that we know of dies. We spend like a whole page looking at that and doesn't feel good, even though there is not really tears or anything, we still feel emotion. Characters are happy, that one happens very, very rarely, but still when it happens, feels great, and you know, it's properly conveyed to us in those particular situations. And are there like a few pages which should be very emotional but don't exactly hit? Yes, but for the most part, with this generic art style and art direction, the fact that there is any emotion in here kinda elevates the whole thing. Sadly though, the fights aren't that great. In most cases, we just get like a highlight of the battle or something and we move on. And, you know, those look fairly good, but when we get actual like combat in action, it feels pretty cool. It's not amazing, but it's there, and the art in general functions as it's supposed to. It's there to support and to help with the narrative, which is the main thing you're going to be reading the manga for. Time loops aren't exactly the most original concept. I have seen other things. This isn't anything particularly new to me. However, it still feels great because there are all of these strange mini quests. But if this is like your first exposure to time loops, you're gonna have a great time. It's genuinely interesting to see what our characters are going to do in certain situations, and that remains, to be really honest with you. But again, the main thing that carries this is all of the little things that our main character does. And by that I mean him learning like which thing he should get to like bring to another person so they can give him something else, so he can give that to another person, or be at a certain time in the day in a certain place. It's very engaging watching him build out this very, very tight schedule and him functioning in that and getting better with every loop. It's That's what will hold your attention for the most part. Unfortunately, however, if you decide to reflect a little bit on what happens in the manga, cracks are going to start showing. The monsters, for example, naturally serve a very big function in the whole story, but they by themselves are not like scary at all. They're just a bunch of circles with mouths, and they can like shoot shit from their mouths and like grow spikes or whatever the fuck, and they're very hard to destroy too, because the narrative needs that. but they do the just that. They just like kind of like a puzzle piece fit exactly where they're supposed to. They're not creative in any way. They just kind of like exist because they have to. The secrets, I'm not gonna spoil anything, but the whole mystery that's driving us along through these 17 chapters isn't that complicated either. It's just kind of like a thing in the world. It's simple, it's generic, it's like basic writing that we're observing here, unfortunately. But you know, the mystery was fun while it was there. Now this may feel like a nitpick, but what the fuck is up with these suits, man? The battle suits essentially have a training wheels on them. This feature called auto-balancing, you learn about it in the first like 3 chapters or whatever. And auto-balancing is essentially, if you suck in your suit, it brings you to like an average level, but if you want to exceed that average level, you have to like turn off the feature and actually learn how to use the battle suit. And virtually everybody uses the training wheels. Only a few specific characters that are like very important and very advanced don't use the training wheels. But at the same time, we observe our character, and only in a few loops he learns how to use the fucking battle suit without the auto balancing feature. So he's like already slightly above average. That's only after a few days. And what the fuck, why can't everybody else just like train for a little bit? Technically, we start the story like 2 days before a combat mission, so of course they can't, you know, be super fucking advanced. But they had time before that, and technically this is supposed to be like the last resort that humanity has. Why the fuck aren't these dudes receiving like proper training? I don't understand. I will stop bitching in a quick second, but before that, I just, come on, dude. The day before the actual combat mission, these dudes go out and do a drill in which they do push-ups for 3 hours straight. Mind you, it doesn't matter how actually buff you are to operate the suit. Well, the main character, or the second main character, is very, very frail, and she is like one of the best fucking combat machines the humanity has. It doesn't matter how powerful you are, why don't our dudes for like even 3 hours try to train with the fucking suits or something? This is stupid. It's shit like that, that if you think a little too much about it, kind of like fucking it shits itself. That's what it does. Okay, yeah, that's enough of that. I feel like you get the picture here. Some story beats, not exactly great. However, when it comes to the teams, they're technically there and they technically exist, and everything steps on colors. That's right, red and blue are the two colors for the covers, and they're mentioned in the last part of the last chapter, and that's about it. So, you know, theoretically, if you reach far enough, you could pull out something out of your ass about how red makes everybody, you know, focus on you, and the blue is so vast and so hopeful or whatever the fuck, but there's nothing actually in the manga to support that, apart from like those 2 pages at the end, which, you know, it would be great if there was actually something, but there's not. It's disappointing. Moving on to the characters. I want to say this right off the bat, the 2 main characters, they're great. I enjoyed their progression throughout the story very much. However, you know, I want to mention the side characters, of which there are exactly 3, or you know, the 4, if we're being generous with it. When you think about it, it's actually pretty admirable that they even tried to characterize these dudes. They didn't succeed, of course, because technically everybody can be summarized as like exactly like 5 lines of text, but still, you know, they're pretty chill, apart from this girl. Whenever she was shown, she felt like she was just like wasting our time and the main character's time. In fact, this exact scene in which our character needs something from her, and he like offhandedly mentions the other main character, and she goes, "Well, you say that, but I talked with her and she said she can live her life on the battlefield. Can you really say that for yourself?" And I remember the main character, this very specific panel of the main character, just like staring into the nothingness and thinking, it wasn't specifically said, but you know, I felt it in my heart, and thinking, damn bitch, can we just fucking move on already? So when there is a stupid character moment, I feel like the manga itself acknowledges that. So when it comes to side characters, they're okay, but the main two characters, they actually go through a lot, you could say, and that leads to a lot of character development and puts them in a lot of interesting and, for us, engaging situations that are always fun to observe. Now, with that said, right, I still enjoyed them and their connection to each other, everything was great on that front. However, it's very natural that in these 17 chapters, we don't really get to spend a lot of time with them, so all of the characterization, all of the progress in their personalities isn't exactly felt, because we simply don't have time to sit with them. We see them changing, but we're not exactly sure what they're changing from, and then the next change happens, and whoa, shit, I didn't even get used to the last version of you, what the fuck is that? Shit like that happens fairly often. But I still genuinely really like the main character, even the secondary main character, they were both great, and if you're having a good day, you have fun with them, but the rest of the time, they're just kinda generic. Yeah, I'm sorry to do that to you and to the manga, which I genuinely wanted to like, but I'm just, you know, this feels a little too generic for me, and maybe a little too simple in some aspects, and for the most part, I feel like that's due to the fact that this was actually a novel that was adapted into a manga, which is very rare. Most cases, manga is always the source of whatever the fuck you're watching and observing, but in here, the novel was actually first, so I'm sure a lot of things were lost in translation. I'm sure the fucking monsters were way scarier, the battle suits actually like made sense, why they're fucking so complicated to use or whatever. And who knows, maybe the fucking colors made sense in there, I don't know, I'm not gonna read it, but for the manga, which it should be able to stand on its own feet, it does, and it's pretty generic. If you're new here and you don't know this is a bit of a book club I'm doing here, in which you know the next three mangas that I'm gonna be reviewing, and those are Dungeon Meshi, which is about this standard classic fantasy D&D party that goes into dungeons and like kills shit, gathers materials, and cooks fancy ass meals. Next manga is King of Fighters New Beginning, which is like loosely based on this old ass fighting game, but for the most part it's just like dudes with creative designs beating the shit out of each other, because it's like one whole big tournament arc. It's pretty fun. And last but not least, the manga that I'm announcing right now is One Punch Man. That's right, baby, I'm doing big hitters now, I'm a big boy. If you somehow don't know what One Punch Man is, it was like a big anime phenomenon a few years ago, but it's about this dude that like can kill anything in one punch. It's supposed to be funny, but it's actually very entertaining, because our guy is placed in these very creative situations, and it's actually just funny watching the characters around him kind of like battle it out. It's pretty fun in that aspect, and by the way, there are two versions, one of them is with a more simplistic art style, I guess you could call it, and the other one is just like really fancy. I'm gonna be reviewing the fancy one. That's about it for that. Social media, the show has those. I post manga panels every other day. Want some manga shit on your timeline? That's a damn good fine place for that. Thanks for engaging with my shit. See ya 4 days in the future, baby.